I can just pull out and let it twist up. And my hands tend to shake now and then, so if I don't do lots right now, that's why. But literally, I've been able to spin enough to make lots of things like a couple of shawls that are over here on a replica spindle. It is a very practical tool with modern fibers. They don't have to be commercially processed. This just happens to be the easiest thing to teach and demonstrate with. Yes, I do have some prints like this that are available. It's not really that I'm trying to get rich. It's quite the opposite. I had a hard time getting my samples back when I would go out and show them to people. And they would tend to sort of want to walk away with them. So I learned very quickly that I wasn't the only one who thought the design was practical. We do still have a lot of questions to answer, and I'm still working on answering them. Most of you probably saw a travelogue that was emailed out as part of one of your newsletters or a supplement to a newsletter. I got invited to an international archaeology meeting about ancient textiles. And the more I started talking about this with people, the more they started bringing me tools and pictures of tools and saying, I have this stick. Is this a distaff? And part of the problem is that distaffs were overlooked for so long, you know, that they were sort of treated like hat racks. It's just a stick to hang things on, so who cares about it? People didn't pay attention to how they looked, how they worked, and they're almost always misidentified. The majority of them are listed as wine stirrers, voting sticks, spindles, medical implements. There's a gold-plated one in a museum in London that's actually listed as a Roman medical probe. I have so many questions about that I don't even want to... I still haven't figured out how anybody thinks this could be a wine stirrer. I mean, really, you're going to hold it by the bird and do this, or... you're going to drown the bird. And I had one curator at a major museum tell me this was the cork that goes in the top of the bottle. Really? The Romans who made aqueducts that go on for miles with a perfect 3% grade couldn't probably design a better wine stirrer. But it makes a wonderful distaff. And the problem is these really are misidentified all over the place, and that means that there's this fun thing, that you don't have to have a degree in the field to come and play. Keep your eyes open when you look around at ancient things. You never know what insights you're gonna have, and you know, maybe in a few years you'll be the one telling the Metropolitan Museum that, guys, you got it wrong. Trust me, that's a lot of fun. I did bring copies. I brought artifacts, but I love commercial combed top because it's readily available. If I'm at home, I do love hand combed fibers too. Sometimes I take a bat from a small drum carder and roll it up in a tube. I may have to elongate it just a little bit, but you can load that directly on. If I'm using hand combed fibers on one of these big tall distaffs, I usually wind up layering two or three combings together to make something a little bit thicker. I have some copies of that small distaff with the bird on it that I love to use for spinning very fine tops like silk top, which is usually a much finer kind of preparation. Anyway, I'm going to take this first little tail end and just wrap it around the top of my distaff once to kind of hold it in place. And then, basically, I'm holding distaff in my right hand and just turning it to wrap on. I'm going to add in a little bit of twist now and then, not to twist it tightly, but just to keep the layers of wool from getting stuck on each other. Am I sure this is the way that the Romans did it? Of course not. But there are some pictures that certainly show something sort of spiral shaped like this. There's even a class of seashell where the Latin name means distaff, which kind of gives you an idea that I'm not the first person who thinks this makes sense. But this is what seems to work, and it is at least consistent with what we know. So, loaded distaff, the wool, I'm gonna keep the swirl across the top of my hand so that the wool isn't sticking to my hand, especially if I'm outside in the summer where my hand might get sticky. And then the wool makes a kind of S bend under that whirl, under my finger, and then back out. So I'm ready to go. And if I'm pulling down a little too hard and it's wanting to slide a little bit too fast, I can close my hand for just a minute and control that speed of release. Also, I think when you spin very fine thread, you may want to explore park and draft again. I can make a pretty good case that the Romans probably did that. One glass spindle whirls would be a real pain if you dropped them. And so I'm thinking that control was good. But when you have something like that little light whirl, it generates twist so fast that it's also going to want to untwist fairly quickly. And you need an awful lot of twist to support very fine thread, but untwisting is a pain in the neck. So if you park and draft, if you just give it a quick spin and then draft out of 8 or 10 inches of thread and give it another spin, you're good to go. And if I really am worried that my thread is going to slip away while I wind on, I can always loop my pinky over it for just a minute, wind it up on my spindle, and I'm good to go again. That sort of
Thank
makes
you.
Sense?
Yes.
Yeah, come and try it.